So Ram has nicely told about first-time dislocators, and what Chirag has asked me to do is tell about how you perform a good arthroscopic Bankart repair. First of all, I want to see why this question arises first. We look at the literature. I picked up only two studies. One study was published in 2019, another was published from 2015. This study at 2019 is a long-term outcome of arthroscopic Bankart repair with suture anchor, which is a modern technique only. And they quote a recurrence rate of almost around 23 to 35%. And another study which I have quoted is here is from Sugaya Group. And the study is published in JBJS American in 2015. And here they have only taken patients with chronic osseous Bankart lesions. And they have done about 8 years follow-up. And out of some 85 patients, they had only two or three who had dislocations. So which means less than around 3% rate. So such a variation in recurrence of dislocation after doing a Bankart surgery. One group comes with a rate of 3%, another group comes with a rate of 35%. So what are we missing? Are we missing something? Or how we can make a better outcome in all these patients? That's what is the question. And how the surgical technique plays a role in this also, I'm going to show it. So, in my view, actually, how you determine the outcome is, you can divide it into like four types of situations. Where is a patient factor, how you choose your indication and what type of surgery, and how your surgical technique is being done, and how you are rehabilitating the patient. In this, the most important thing is about surgical technique. It's not standardized yet, because everyone has got minor variation how they practice, and that also accounts to the outcome of the patient. So first, let us see these patient factors. We can control the indication in this surgical technique rehabilitation. But what we can control is the patient factors. That's not in our hand. And what I think that are playing in this is something called high risk categories, where age is something. When anyone in the lower age group around 20, they are going to have a highest recurrence rate even after doing surgery. And those with ligamentous laxity, and those who are contact athletes, and those number of dislocations before intervention. Like more number of dislocations, more they are going to have injury to the capsular structures, and also the, you will see more often bony Bankart and Hill-Sack lesion also. Even the age, those in the, if you see this paper, somewhere between, which is around 15 to 20 age group, and they quote reference rate of around 24% after doing a fantastic Bankart repair. So they have done an excellent Bankart repair, still the recurrence rate is almost around 24 to 30%. And if there is a bony defect, it becomes even much more complicated, and is invariable to have a bony defect in the less than 10% bony defect in the glenoid side. And to my knowledge, Hill-Sack is there in all the patients. If you can't Hill-Sack, at least in MRI you will see a bone bruising over there, which means definitely there is a damage bone is us also, and also for the remember that it is common. Only thing where the less common is more than 25% bone defect. You all come across around 10 to 15% bone defect, very, very common. If you don't manage properly, then they're going to have a recurrence of dislocation. Pascal Bailo told, those who are having ligamentous laxity, they are going to have a high chance of having a recurrence of dislocation after surgery. And he, in fact, pointed out that you should put at least four anchor points when you are dealing with a patient who is having a ligamentous laxity. So you need to pay attention to these patients in the high-risk groups. So age and athletic is a bad combination. Younger age group, who is a contact athlete, they are going to have a very highest of recurrence of dislocation, almost 30%. So these are the companies to have low age, high ligamentous laxity, contact athletes, and many number of dislocations before intervention. These patient factors, we have very little control in the bringing outcome, but what we can make difference is by doing a good surgical technique. So, go in detail about the talks about talks, and also I'm not going to go in detail about it. I'll just go into the surgical technique. Surgical technique is very, very important, and how we can make differences in precision in our surgical procedure. And what I understand is Bankart surgery is not just ligament repairing surgery, what we are trying to achieve. Normally, it's a repairing a static stabilizer, which is inferior glenohumeral ligament, and the capsular labral sector attached. That's what we are trying to attach together. And also, there are dynamic stabilizers called rotator dynamic stabilizers. For example, which can actually group, we should address that also. Otherwise, the patient will have slightly unstable shoulder. So, in my view, has got a which is well centered. Humerus will be well centered on the glenoid. But if somebody has got a lateral tear or anterior labral lesion, any sort of it, whether it's a the center of the glenoid in any position. So this is, they have that unequal tension with the tension, less tension on the anterior side, so the humerus easily comes out. This is what one has to understand on our procedure. The procedure is to bring them equally both anterior and posterior. Otherwise, you're going to have a high risk of reflocation. So I'll just show the case example and then we'll go into the surgical technique. For this patient, I've got an anterior tension. For abduction, rotation, which is very painful, and relocation becomes painless. Once you such a diagnosis that more and need not confirm the diagnosis to identify. So let's go to the surgical steps. The first very first is you are putting the through the posterior porta. These are the trauma that you have to identify. What you are seeing is a subscapularis tendon. This is a bicep tendon. This is a left shoulder where I put the scope on the posterior portal, and I am doing a rotatory interval. And here I have done two markings, one marking for one portal, anterior superior portal, another is anterior inferior portal, which will be just proximal to the subscapularis. So here is the subscapular tendon, here is a bicep tendon. I'm putting a needle through the anterior superior area. And another needle over the subscap is going to the anterior inferior portal and anterior superior portal. These are the two working horses for us. And introduce a 11 blade and make sure incise to about 7 or 8 mm because I'm going to introduce a 8 mm cannula through that. First put a Visinger rod and make sure the Visinger rod reaches right down to the inferior most part of the glenoid labrum. That's our important play point is going to be. And then introduce the Visinger rod below the breast by making a small incision over there. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to shift my camera to the posterior portal, the anterior side portal, so the end-on view of the labral tear. Then you have gone to the anterior portal and you will see the structures. This is the labrum, here is a glenoid, and that's a capsule. This labrum here is gone medially far due to several dislocations. Next step is to try to establish the posterior cannula. So, and after establishing posterior cannula, you have to bring that labrum, which is displaced medially, to float out. You have to bring it out. I usually do it from the farther end, which is the most inferior, so that you can try to detach it from the most inferior capsule slowly and take it in one piece, so that you don't have any shedding of the labrum. Try to make it to float it, and it has to come to the level of the glenoid bone. Then only we know, we can be sure that yeah, this is actually a non-union, what we call it as a mal, where there's no place where people are having a recurrent dislocation. So the next step is to fresh the bony margins over here. So to fresh the bony margins, you can use a liberator or a rasp, or you can use a bony margin and then use the suture passing device through the inferior. You should take almost up to the about 6 o'clock position and try to take a suture material through the anterior and try to pull it and see whether you're able to bring the tension of the anterior reaction back. This is a very important step. Once you treat appropriately, you will see that head of the humerus come to the center of the glenoid. This is called tensioning procedure. And this is the most important. And then once you have done that, next step is to put your anchor. Where put the anchor? It's a very, very much debate about whether should you put on the end face over here or should you put on the margins over there. If you put it on the margin, what happens is you are not trying to bring the heaped up labrum over the top of the glenoid. You will bring the labrum below the glenoid. So it's not shown to reproduce anatomy much more better if you put on the glenoid. Glenoid just over the margin, not below the margin. So here I will show you how I do the putting the anchoring. So this is at around 5 o'clock position, where you put keep your sleeve over and try to delete, leaving a small bony bridge. So leave a bony bridge of about 2 mm. Otherwise, you will break off and the anchor can slip out over there, a pilot hole over there. Once the pilot hole is done. Here I am using an anchor, and then I will load the Nautilus over there. And doing this, actually, you have to make sure the tension of the anterior capsule is brought back to normal. So as you see this now, as the anchor is going in, your anterior inferior capsule gets tightened up. This is very important to re-establish the tension of the anterior inferior capsule. So as this anchor goes in for the 1 centimeter, that 1 centimeter of capsular tissue comes to the closer to the glenoid and that becomes tightened. So that is the way you have to bring the anterior inferior capsule much proximally. So next step is again, now you have to put next anchor. So for that, again, you are going to take capsular tissue, which is leftover capsular tissue from anchor at 5 o'clock. Similarly, we are taking around the 4th and 3rd. Proximal anterior inferior capsule so that the tension is re-established. So the same principle again, you are trying to establish a capsular tension from so that tension is re-established. But once you are in around the 3 o'clock position, that that labeled passing device anterior very well, then you have to use future positive device. When you take at least 1 centimeter of capsule, as I have shown here, try to take 1 centimeter of capsule so that you can re-establish the tension back. Because all the patients with labral tear will also have some capsular laxity. Extra bit of capsule, only then. Passing another anchor to the around about 3:30 to 2:30.
I think there is a problem in the internet connection there.
Yeah, I think even the video was breaking a little bit. Okay, till. Subra sir, are you there?
I think somebody needs to inform him, I think. I don't think he realizes that, you know, that a video or audio is not being transmitted.
Yes, yes.
Till then, Dr. Shushal, can you generate some?
Yeah.
Chiragi, tell Neeraj to inform us, Subra.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think in the meanwhile, I think we can have some conversation. So far, I think the first two anchors have been pretty clear.
No connection.
Rest of the faculty, would you do anything different? Anything you want to?
No, this is exactly what Dr. Madan is very fond of, knotless anchors.
I wanted to ask this question. How many of them use knotless and how many use the normal knot tying this one in this group? Because always, I don't know, most of the time when you go inferior, when you try to use a knotless, you get a good inferior capsular shift when you use a knotless. And then you start using a knotted ones. I want to know the panel, like, what are their choices?
So I use all suture anchors knotless, knotted, single or double loaded. I think the problem with that is it's a very good point. But sometimes when you're hammering, especially the inferior, there's a chance that, you know, you can break through the cortex. So that is...
Subrasa is back, I think.
Can you hear me? The net connection got dropped. How far did you see?
Videos were also breaking in between, but after the second anchor, we are not able to see anything.
Oh, there are only three more slides. Shall we go through it or how? There are only three more slides.
Yeah, I can go.
I'll just put on the share screen mode again, okay? Yeah. See it now?
Yeah.
Yes. We are with you.
Are you able to see it now?
No.
Yeah.
Okay, right. So this is the second suture going through the labrum. And I am putting my anchor around position with inferior capsular labral tissue taken at around 5 o'clock position, so that you are trying to proximize the capsular labral tissue from inferior to proximal end. That's what is happening in this slide. So next is, once you are up into the most proximal end, you cannot take a bite with your scorpion takeout device, then you have to use your acid device. So here what I am doing is I am taking almost 1 centimeter capsule from anterior end to the medial most end, so that you have enough capsular tissue to tension it. So once you have taken that through the railroad technique, you pass it to another anchor at around 230 position, you are still tensioning that anterior capsule. So you are gradually tensioning from inferior to superior and also anterior capsule also. So all the three steps you are doing together, so that you are trying to tension the whole nicely and snugly. So this happens in, you have to make sure your head of the humerus is centered on the glenoid at the end. So what is happening is, once the anterior capsular tissue is tightened very well, your head of the humerus will come and nicely sit in the center of the glenoid. That shows that your tensioning has been done appropriately. So that is the ultimate thing that you have to achieve in each and every case when you are doing a anterior labral repair. So what I call it as, this is not just a labral repair. It is inferior capsular shift, anterior labral repair, and anterior capsular tightening. All the three together forms a total arthroscopic banker surgery. And try to get this heat effect. And the studies have shown that when you do this heat effect, you can see the glenoid anatomy or glenoid morphology looks almost similar to the normal glenoid. It becomes akin to that. So make sure you try to get a heaped up effect in each and every case. So post-operative swinging for about 6 weeks time, abduction about 10 weeks. Only movement that has been shown in literature is that external rotation should be avoided. That is the only movement that tries to bring the tension on your tissue that has been stitched. So try to avoid that for about 10 weeks at a minimum. So take home message, assess whether it's a soft knee banker, consider appropriate procedure depending on the bone loss. Outcome is dictated by many factors, but the surgical technique is the most important one that you have to do precise acumen for that. Give importance to individual steps, and the surgical technique is very important. Procedure should restore the tension of the anterior capsular labral structures appropriately. Thank you.